Hello, my name is Rachael Berman, and I'm the Grassroots and Celebrant Program Coordinator for the American Humanist Association. Today, I'm joined by Ryan Jean, Army Major and Humanist Celebrant, as well as a member of the Military Association for Atheists and Freethinkers. We're here to talk about Veterans Day and Freethinkers in the Military.
Oh, hello. Thank you for inviting me today.
We're really happy you're here. So we're going to start by talking about you, yourself. Can you give us a little bit of your background and kind of how you got into the military in the first place?
Well, my background, without going into too much length here, is I was raised in a family that was fairly well off, but fairly committed to the idea of giving back. So when I got to about the high school area, high school age, I had my grandfathers, both of whom served in the military, as inspirations to me. And I kind of made a decision that that would be the way I would choose to give back. And so I went through high school ROTC. I went through college ROTC. I got commissioned in the Army in 2003. And I've been working in the intelligence field since.
And have you identified as a free thinker the entire time that you've been in the military?
No. When I joined the military, I was still actually a Christian. The original version of my oath of office still has the "so help me God." However, the subsequent versions that I have done as I've been promoted through the ranks have omitted that phrase. You don't have to do the paperwork again, but at least when saying it out loud for the oath, I have omitted those since then, since that is legally permissible to do. I started transitioning towards losing my faith between about the time that I got commissioned and around 2006, 2007. I'd say by then I was probably fairly confident in being an atheist, but I didn't really know what I was beyond that. For me, the real change happened when I was deployed, and the Army at the time had actually just switched to doing a spiritual fitness program as part of its overall soldier readiness tracking techniques. And it was a new effort, and the results of the items would be reported to your chain of command in case there were any areas that you weren't scoring well on that may be a concern to the command. While the spiritual fitness was heavily religiously themed,
right.
They have stripped it down over the years, mostly because of complaints from groups like the Military Religious Freedom Foundation and efforts on those parts, but it still has that tinge to it to this day. But the big problem was that the spiritual fitness was the one area of the fitness test that I did not pass, and I got sent by my command to go see a chaplain in theater. The command chaplain wasn't there, but the deputy chaplain that did see me berated me and said that I should stop disgracing the military and, you know, quit my commission if I can't serve God.
And what did you do?
I pretty much huffed out of there. I didn't, you know, at the time, this guy outranked me. It was a situation where I was still coming to terms with a lot of what I did believe. But what it did is it kind of started a process in me where I wanted to be more active fighting against that kind of extreme event. And those events aren't always that common. I mean, that there are many, many good chaplains that would not do that.
Right.
I just happened to be in the, I guess, the wrong place at the right time to stoke that fire.
Yeah.
And since then, one of the things that's done is that's helped in the journey from being an atheist to being much more of a humanist in valuing the different outlooks, in valuing the common humanity, and recognizing that from the background I grew up in, all of a sudden, as an atheist, for the first time in my life, I was a member of a minority group.
Mm-hmm.
And it gave me perspective, and that helped me grow beyond just automatically being the privileged person I was.
Right. And so I would assume that there are other obstacles besides the one that you just gave us that free thinkers face in the military. Can you kind of talk about either personal examples or examples that you've heard of that would be common?
Well, there's a variety that happened throughout, and every experience will vary. I've spoken with career people who've retired who've never had a problem their entire career.
Right.
I've had to stop some sergeants, well, actually it happened on one occasion where I had to stop a sergeant from requiring his troops to go to church service on a Sunday.
Wow.
And pointing out that he can't actually do that. He can't require them, and he can't punish them for not. It's almost a cliche at this point. It is largely true, but it's almost a cliche that in boot camp, if you don't go to church service on Sunday, you're probably going to be stuck cleaning the barracks. So they do give you the option.
Mm-hmm.
So
it's not really a great look.
It's not a, yeah, it's not a very
good
option.
Not enticing. Yeah, not too enticing.
And since that's become an issue, there have been groups that have popped up to provide support for that by providing an alternative location. In particular, for example, Lackland Air Force
Base. That's exactly what I was going to say. They
has a very strong.
They have 300 people more or less every week that come out to the group. It's really thriving.
And it really depends on where you are, base, what the command climate is at that base with regard to how respectful they are of the, for lack of better terms, non-traditional stances on the religious question. Some places are downright hostile to it. Some places are very permissive to it, as long as it doesn't get in the way of the command itself.
Mm-hmm.
And it just is completely variable. One dynamic you will notice is it tends to have much more success at basic training locations because that is a truly captive audience in a way that many other places are not within the military. I'm currently stationed in the Fort Meade area, and as that has some schools at it, but it doesn't have a basic training item. And so the humanist community there is small and doesn't really have as much activity going on as some of the basic training locations do.
And so you kind of touched on originally about the chaplaincy aspect, and kind of when that event happened, you were taken right to the chaplain, kind of on base to talk about the experience that you had. Can you tell me more about chaplaincy for specifically humanists or free thinkers that are in the military? Kind of, are there any? If so, talk about that. If not, why not?
Well, given what we know from things like the Clergy Project about people who are actual serving clergy in, local ministries that don't believe and have to find an exit ramp because their entire life is invested in that, I'm highly confident that there are some chaplains as well that have lost the faith but don't want to lose the endorsement from their from their religious body and don't know what they would do because right now the military is in a kind of flux zone. It recognizes that humanists and atheists exist, but it doesn't recognize anything beyond that we exist.
So as individuals?
As individuals, for example, the Army actually allows you to specify on dog tags
humanists,
and I have humanists on my own dog tags.
Yep.
That was fought after a several-year-long battle by a fellow major and friend of mine who submitted the necessary paperwork to start the process, but also followed it up with Inspector General complaints and equal opportunity complaints in order to push it through the process to get fairly considered.
Right.
And part of the problem is, unless you're a careerist who's very stable, that kind of paperwork effort is absolutely maddeningly difficult.
Yep.
And that's one of the hurdles that makes a lot of this change difficult. The other services do not allow humanist on dog tags. They do allow atheist, agnostic, and there's the classic no religious preference, which is kind of a catch-all term for anybody who didn't declare anything.
Right.
So there are alternative terms on there, but the chaplaincy itself doesn't recognize other than that we are there. They don't recognize us as a faith group one way or another, or as a faith stance even so much as just a group to kind of ignore. They see their role as providing a specifically strongly religious ministry, and only secondarily to support free exercise. And from a constitutional standpoint, that's exactly the opposite.
100%.
They are supposed to be free exercise first and foremost, and then their individual ministry second. So there are efforts, certainly, to get atheists and humanists in more recognition. I personally applied to be a humanist lay leader at one point before the Army actually changed its regulations in a way that specifically bans that. They changed it in such a way that it basically removes lay leader, which is like a volunteer working with the chaplaincy, to prohibit lay leaders that are non that are non-religious in nature.
Really?
And so a humanist one, because there's divide on whether or not humanist even counts as a religion or not, and it's the practical versus the legal distinction versus
right.
so many different factors,
right.
and even myself, I'm not quite sure what I want to say on that.
Yes.
I consider it a very strong philosophy, a philosophy of
Absolutely.
Life that is equivalent to religion, but because it doesn't have a dogmatic side to it,
right.
I don't know what to answer if the chaplain sit there and say, are you a religion?
Right. It's a hard defense in some ways.
It is very difficult. And that's threading that needle is always going to be a challenge. But there are other efforts. For example, there's an individual who has attempted, and he's on his second attempt now after being denied the first time and appealing the process. He's on his second attempt to become a humanist chaplain on behalf of the U.S. Navy.
Right.
He is probably one of the most qualified candidates
yes.
for the chaplaincy at all.
Right.
And yet, it's an absolute uphill battle the moment they found out that his endorsing agent was not a traditional religious group.
Right.
The chaplaincy itself, like I said, they kind of ignore us. They kind of just look at us as, ragtag children that can just be pushed off to the side. And they don't really want to provide any recognition for us. And unfortunately, that goes so far as to say they don't really want recognition even secondarily. Like, they don't... Many chaplains, for example, are not opposed to humanist and atheist groups meeting on post.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
They're opposed to humanist and atheist groups having the same protections for meeting on post and the same privileges
as
a religious group would.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
that includes everything from designated meeting spaces.
Right?
As opposed
Times,
to
books, materials.
Getting materials passed
yep,
out.
Yep.
Getting it advertised so that the command knows that it's an option. You know,
existing in the
option.
First place. Right. Promotion, things like that.
Or even... It may not seem like that much of a deal, but if you're a private group on post and you want to use, say, the side room of the fitness center,
right,
you have to rent it out. A religious group does not.
Right. Yeah.
If they're under the chaplaincy.
Right. Some big challenges. Yeah. So I mentioned earlier that we were going to talk about Veterans Day. So
yes.
today's Veterans Day. So tell me kind of more about why freethinkers, humanists, atheists, everyone under that secular spectrum should care and be and talk about Veterans Day.
Well, fundamentally, we have three real holidays that we talk about when we're talking about the military. There's Memorial Day, there's Soldiers Day, or I forget the exact term for it, which is like a week after, and then there's Veterans Day, and they refer to different attributes of it. Memorial Day is for those who've passed on. Veterans
mm-hmm.
Day is supposed to be for those who are still alive but previously served, and then that. Third one is for those who are still in service.
Mm.
Over the years, the distinctions have kind of blurred on that.
Yeah.
Veterans Day is kind of the catch-all more than anything else. As I am a veteran of a foreign war, I qualify for that, even though I'm still serving under that.
Mm-hmm.
But realistically, what's important about the context for Veterans Day with humanists, atheists, free thinkers, is the military... is fundamentally the arm that ensures that the rights that all, not just American citizens, but humans within our society have, are protected and respected. Without the military, it's not that we go to battle in the legislature or something like that,
mm-hmm.
but without having muscle to back it up, rights will get trampled on. And we see that regularly. And in fact, in our political climate right now, we're concerned about that very issue.
Mm-hmm.
So it's not that you have to respect the military or think the military always does good. I certainly don't think my own military does always good. I think it has a good purpose,
mm-hmm.
but I think it makes mistakes just as any human endeavor will.
Right.
Sometimes that means bad wars. Sometimes that means individual just bad decisions.
Mm-hmm.
But overall, the purpose, the fundamental item... We are one of the only militaries in the world that exists to defend a political ideal rather than a specific entity.
Mm-hmm.
We exist to protect the Constitution and what it stands for as a protector of people's rights,
right.
not to protect any given particular president or the Congress in particular, although we will defend them by virtue of their office.
Mm-hmm.
And that was completely new on the world when it came out, and it is still a beacon of hope throughout the world for a more pluralistic world where people have these rights respected, these inviolable principles being upheld, because they may seem inviolable on paper, but if somebody's not there to be the backstop, they will be violated.
Mm-hmm. So, as I mentioned earlier, you're a member of the Military Association of Atheists and Freethinkers. So tell me more about how you even found this group in the first place, and kind of, you know, the mission of this, of the group, and, you know, the organizational structure and the members, how people can find out more, you know, kind of tell me everything that's inclusive under this organization.
Well, MAF, as it's known, MAAF, is kind of a catch-all support program for helping to coordinate and provide resources for a lot of those, for example, humanist groups at Lackland Air Force Base, as one great example. They are kind of the central point. They exist as a nonprofit that does a combination of the, I don't want to call it lobbying. It's not that we're pumping tons of money into congressional offices here. It's more along the lines of having a subject matter expert able to defend it on the Hill.
Yes.
And able to provide resources and coordination to the people out and mm-hmm. about in the various military locations. So the purpose of MAF is largely that principal defense item. It is not about, for example, filing lawsuits.
Mm-hmm.
The occasional FOIA request might be done, Freedom of Information Act, to get information for some of the efforts being done, but it's not an organization that's trying to use the courts to impose something. It's really about providing that coordination effort.
Mm-hmm. And if you're not a member of the military, can you still be a member of MAF?
Yes. You can still be a member of MAF as a supporter, one way or another, get the information on what's going on. There are other ways to volunteer and support if you happen to be near a base location
mm-hmm.
that could use that support. It's predominantly targeted at people who are or are former military.
Of course.
And in fact, the membership fee, which, you know, is the primary way in which the individual runs it, Jason Torpy, operates day-to-day on that, is through those small membership fees. The membership fee is waived if you're actually active serving military.
And how are there events that MAF holds, or is it, you know, individual within each base? You know, how does that work?
It tends to be individual because, like I said, a lot of what his effort is the coordination of the nationwide efforts for making sure support is available. So when the chaplaincy denies support, what he goes in is he then contacts the command and makes sure they know why it's appropriate to provide this support on the side, and
mm-hmm.
helps link the command to the volunteers who are providing that support, since the chaplaincy won't.
Yeah. So if people want to become either a member or engage in the organization, or if they want to, you know, volunteer, how can they go about that? How can they find MAF in the first place?
Well, the website is militaryatheists.org. And that would be a great place to start. It also has a lot of resources. If you are in the military and you're wondering about what resources are available or how to approach a chaplain
right.
when asking for support,
that's
for
perfect.
Example, they have all of that on the website right there that you can go through and look up a history of the various regulations for each service. So it's not just Army or Navy, it's DOD and down.
That's great.
For all of the different regulations that affect humanist and atheist and freethinker support from the chaplaincy, from the other manuals, whatever, and you can see how they've changed over time that way. He has statistics that you can use to argue. One of the interesting points is that it was his statistics that had actually been used in other publications to that effect to point out that atheists, humanists, and agnostics, not just the no religious preference, the specific
right.
people who actually put Label one of those
as
labels
such. Yeah.
outnumber all Jews, atheists, or I'm sorry, all Jews, Muslims, and Buddhists combined in the military.
That's pretty incredible.
And, you know, there are Jewish chaplains.
Yes.
There are Muslim chaplains.
Yes.
There are Buddhist chaplains. There are no humanist chaplains. And I understand that's a contentious issue, but if the item is about providing coordinated support to all,
Right.
We have to think outside the box.
Absolutely. So for more information about the American Humanist Association or ways in which you can become a member, you can go to their website at AmericanHumanist.org.
As well, if anybody has any specific questions or comments for me in particular, I will, for a day or so after the video gets put online, track the comments on that and would be happy to answer any questions. As well, if people have specific questions or comments that they'd like to privately direct at me, I have my humanist work email, which is army.humanist@gmail.com.
Perfect. Thanks for listening.